In this video, we're going to talk about some very basic economic concepts that are at the heart of modern microeconomics. As economists define this, the fundamental economic problem is that we have limited resources, but effectively unlimited ones, that we want to do more than we have resources available for. That's true both at the level of individuals and at the level of society. Therefore, economists define the fundamental economic problem is that we don't have enough resources to do everything that we want. And therefore, we define economics to be the study of how individuals and societies deal with this fundamental issue of scarcity. Because we don't have enough time to do everything that we'd like to do, we have to choose how we use our time. And for any given moment in time, we can only use that for one task. So whenever we make a choice, we're giving up other choices. That's true about how we spend our money as individuals. It's true about how we spend our time as individuals. And it's also true about how firms and organizations and society as a whole makes its decisions. Once you devote resources to one activity, they're not available for alternative uses at the same time. If we choose to build a building on a given plot of land, that land is not available for farming or as a park. Because a fundamental problem of economics is scarcity, and that implies we need to make choices, economics is ultimately the study of choice. Whenever we make a choice, we give up our next best alternative, that when we choose to go in one direction, at least for some time, we've foregone the possibility of making a different choice. If we spend money on buying a used car, then we don't have that money available to buy more medical services. If we choose to spend our time going out to a movie, we're not using that time to study for a class, like an economics class. The opportunity cost of anything that we do is what we give up in order to do that. These opportunity costs consist of two broad categories. One is the explicit cost, which refers to the actual payment you make for items. So an explicit cost involves an actual payment. So for example, if you go out to dinner, the explicit cost would be the cost to you of the transportation getting there, the cost of the meal, the tip for the service, and so on. But that also has an implicit cost. An implicit cost involves using resources that could have been used in a different way. For example, when you go out to dinner, you're giving up time that you could have used to study. In general, pretty much everything that we do has both explicit costs, things we have to pay for, but also implicit costs in that we're using our time and other resources in different ways. As an example, suppose you own a business and you own the building in which that business exists. In that case, if you already own the building, you're not paying for the use of that building. However, there's still an implicit cost. So in general, the opportunity cost consists of both the explicit payments you make to do something, because that's money that could have been used for something else, as well as the opportunity cost of your time and anything else that you use in that business that could have been used differently. All social sciences focus a substantial amount of effort on trying to explain choice. Economics is not unique that way. Psychology, for example, generally focuses on what influences the choices that people make, where those influences may be social, they may be upbringing, they may be any number of things in an individual's past that influences the choice they make. Sociologists focus primarily on the role of society and social norms on explaining how people make choices. Economists take a somewhat different focus. We tend not to focus too much on how the person's past will influence their current choice, or we tend not to focus too much on the role that society plays, although we have to take those things into account. We tend to focus in economics primarily on the assumption that individuals make decisions based on their rational self-interest. What this means is that we assume that individuals have preferences over all the things they do, and we assume they can rank them from highest to lowest. Rational self-interest just implies that individuals make choices that are highest in their ranking among all the possible things they could have done at that time. So rational self-interest basically is saying that at any given time, we make the choices that seem best for us at that moment. The next day, you may regret some of those choices, but at the time you make those decisions, we're assuming that you're making the decisions that seemed best for you. Note that rational self-interest is not the same as selfishness. Selfishness means you only take yourself into account. Rational self-interest still focused on the self, but what we're assuming with rational self-interest is that you're making choices that make you happiest, but those choices might involve helping other people. They might involve working in charitable organizations. They might involve giving gifts to your friends or loved ones. They may involve participating in a protest march for any number of possibilities. But rational self-interest just means we do what we think best, which could involve substantial cost to ourselves. We read stories often about people who rush into a burning building to try to save someone. That would not generally be considered selfish behavior, but it would be rational self-interest because the person makes a choice because they're happier having done that than to allow someone to die. So rational self-interest could involve giving up things to help other people, and we see many examples of that in the world around us. We do see lots of selfishness too, but economists tend to assume that everyone is pursuing their rational self-interest, regardless of whether that behavior appears to be selfish or not. Now, we talked about having limited resources and unlimited ones. When we talk about society as a whole, we define resources to be those things that are used to produce final goods and services. When we think about that in terms of firms that are producing output, we divide those resources into a few basic concepts. These terms have been used by economists for over a century and a half now. The primary resource, as it's called, is land, which now we tend to think of as natural resources. An economist defined this back in the mid-1800s as consisting of the free gifts of nature, the things that existed out there before there was any sort of human intervention. So the land would consist of the soil, any minerals that exist below the soil, undeveloped land, forests, and so forth. Capital is defined in economics, and this is something you have to be careful with, in a way that's different from its everyday use. Capital as a resource represents the plant and equipment that's used to produce final goods and services. So it would include factories and drill presses. At the college, for example, the dorms and the classroom buildings and the computers are all forms of capital because they're used to produce educational services for students. There are many items that could be capital or they could be consumer goods depending on their use. A car that you own just to drive for your own purposes is considered a consumer good. But if a firm owns a car that is used for deliveries, that would be considered capital. In everyday use, the term capital often represents the financial resources that they use to start a business. That is not the economic definition because it's the actual physical materials that constitute the capital, not the payments that are used to generate that. So stocks and bonds, for example, are not forms of capital in an economic sense. In this class, we'll be careful to define those as financial capital, while capital only refers to the physical objects. The other resource, as defined by economists, is entrepreneurial ability, and that's the ability to manage and run businesses. It also often includes the willingness to bear risk to bring those resources together. So the entrepreneurs are the people who start the businesses and decide what mix of labor and capital is needed to produce output. We should also talk about the distinction between goods and services. Goods are tangible objects, things that you can hold and touch. Services are intangible. An important component of services is that labor is an essential component of the perceived quality of the product. As an example, suppose that you go to a grocery store and you buy a bag of apples. The apples would be a good. If you go to a restaurant and buy a meal, the meal itself would be a good, but the acts of cooking the meal, preparing it, serving it at the table, and cleaning up would be a service. Many of the things we buy actually involve a mix of goods and services. For example, the restaurant meal. Legal services would be another example of a service. Medical services would be another example. In general, goods are things that we can touch and hold. Services are things that involve other people doing some labor to assist you, either in person or perhaps virtually. Now, the last thing we're going to talk about in this video in terms of some basic concepts is the difference between microeconomics and macroeconomics. Microeconomics is defined to be a study of the behavior of individual economic agents and individual markets, while macroeconomics is defined to be the study of economic aggregates. In microeconomics, we focus on the pieces of the economy, the behavior of individuals, or we focus on the behavior of individual markets. So if we're trying to study the market for insulin, for example, that would be microeconomics. Macroeconomics, though, involves a study of aggregates. In aggregate, involves combining many different, possibly unlike things into one broader combination. One of the classic definitions of an aggregate would be GDP, which is gross domestic product, which consists of the value of all final goods and services produced within a nation's border in a given year. And in that measure of GDP, we include socks and cars and trucks and new factories being built and bottled water and many other things that are very unlike items, all lumped together into this one value of the nation's total output. So microeconomics involves focusing on the individual components of the economy. Macroeconomics focuses on the overall performance without worrying as much about the individual details.